Hola amigos, ¿qué tal? Sean ustedes bienvenidos a la entrevista. Hoy tengo el privilegio de contar en esta entrevista con Walter Isaacson. Él es uno de los biógrafos más importantes del mundo. Él ha sido presidente ejecutivo, director de CNN, editor de Time, presidente también del Aspen Institute, y para mí es un placer tenerlo en la línea telefónica. Mr. Isaacson, thank you very much. And I've read the latest book that you've written, The Codebreaker. It's the story of Jennifer Doudna. She won the Nobel Prize. She won the Nobel Prize for breaking the genetic code. But why is that important? You offer us almost a novel-like introduction to the world of genetics and to the life of Jennifer Doudna. Tell us about this book.
It's incredibly important what they've discovered, which is how to edit our human genes. In other words, we can fix genetic diseases now, like sickle cell anemia, muscular dystrophy or Huntington. More importantly, in the next 10 or 15 years, we'll be able to design our children, maybe make them taller or smarter, or make them better athletes, have more muscle mass. And that's a moral question and a policy question we're going to have to decide, is to what extent are we going to use these new tools to edit our human genes?
Mr. Isaacson, is it ethical to do that? Is it ethical to play with our genetic structure?
I think we've found ways to do it that are ethical. Certainly, we do many things to try to protect ourselves from disease. We use vaccinations. We use all sorts of medical and pharmaceutical interventions. I think it might be less ethical to do something that would make inheritable edits. In other words, not only treat a patient, but make edits to that patient's children and all of their descendants. In that case, we'd be editing the human race. The other ethical issue I would say is we can't make it so that the rich would be able to buy better genes for their kids, or that they'd be able to edit out the diversity of our species. We have to make sure if we use this for health reasons, it's available to as many people as possible.
Jennifer Doudna is a fantastic character, a character that really gives life to the entire book. You must have started this work before she earned the Nobel Prize in the year 2020. Tell us, how did you start working on her life, and how did you start working on this biography?
I was interested in the new life science revolution, making genetic edits, for example, or for that matter, using genetics to create vaccines for the coronavirus. And so I was looking for a character who would be sort of the central subject of such a book. And Jennifer Doudna is a perfect subject because as a young graduate student, she helped figure out the structure of RNA. Now, as you know, RNA is key to some of the vaccines we're using, and it's a key part of this tool we have to edit our genes. But then after she did that, she became involved in studying the ethical and policy issues. And then, of course, she wins a Nobel Prize. So it makes her a perfect hero for this book.
And at the same time, she's a scientist, but she's also an entrepreneur. I mean, she has her own company. Tell us about it.
Well, she has created some companies to use CRISPR, which is the name of the gene editing tool she worked on, in order to fight diseases such as sickle cell. And her company, Intellia, just this past week, was able to use CRISPR inside the body of a patient to just edit that patient's blood cells and stem cells so that that patient would no longer have sickle cell anemia. She's also been able to create detection technologies that use CRISPR in a home detection kit you can put on your kitchen counter to see if you have coronavirus or any other virus or bacteria, or maybe if you're cancer.
You've done work, you've written biographies of a number of people who've been exceptionally creative, people like Leonardo da Vinci or Albert Einstein or Steven Jobs. And now you write about Jennifer Doudna. What is the characteristic that unifies them all?
They all have an amazing curiosity. They're curious about everything you can find in nature. They're also very observant, and they're interested in both the arts and the sciences, which I think helps people be more creative. Whenever Steve Jobs introduced a new product, he showed the street sign showing the intersection of the humanities and technology. And he said, if you stand in that intersection, that's where creativity occurs. Well, that's true of Jennifer Doudna, who's both a humanist and an ethicist, but also a really good biologist. And I think we should all appreciate all fields of knowledge, from the humanities to the sciences.
I enjoyed the part of the book in which you said that we're seeing like two rivers coming together, a revolution in mathematics with the binary system and a revolution in genetics. How do these two revolutions actually help us understand life, and what does this mean for the future?
Yes, the digital revolution, which you and I grew up in over the past 50 years, involved connecting the computer, the microchip, and the internet. And everything was done in digital code, zeros and ones. And we discovered that all information and all instructions can be coded in computer code. Well, now we're entering into a new era in which you're going to have to learn also the genetic code, which is the four-letter code that determines our genes, the four-letter code of DNA and also of RNA. And so I think when those two come together, you're going to be able to mine all of the data we have about health, and we'll be able to figure out the genetic causes of some of our problems, and then we'll be able to find out the genetic cures.
We're just at the beginning of the genetic revolution, but what do you expect in maybe 20 or 30 years' time? How is life going to be like?
I think that in 20 or 30 years, we'll be able to eliminate most genetic diseases. The tricky part will be trying to take on diseases that are partially genetic and partially environmental. And that includes a lot of psychological issues like schizophrenia or depression. We'll also be able to take on, be a trickier thing when we decide we want to modify the personalities of ourselves or of our children, or want to eliminate things like depression. And then finally, in about 20 or 30 years, we'll be able to design our children to make them taller, to make them more muscular, to make them more athletic, or maybe even smarter or have better memory. And that's where, as I said before, the ethical issues come in, because we don't want the rich to just be able to buy better genes for their kids. So with this book, I wanted to start the conversation of when and how should we use this technology, and when should we try to regulate it?
What kind of legislation should we have in order not to suffocate investigation, research, and at the same time, beware of whatever, whatever improper use of this technology may be done?
Oh, that's a great question. I like the way you framed it, because it is a balance. We don't want to suffocate this research, but we don't want to allow people to just go in the free market and start editing their children without regard to safety or the consequences for society. So I think the type of regulations we need at the beginning are that we will use this to cure diseases, but not to create enhancements. In other words, if you've got sickle cell anemia and your blood is deformed and it won't carry enough oxygen, we might want to use CRISPR to cure that. But we should not use it to enhance your blood so it carries twice as much oxygen and you get to go to the Olympics right away because you can outrun anybody because your blood has more oxygen levels.
You started to write biographies some years back. What took you to write biographies? What did you think? What did you think that writing biographies was the right way of actually studying aspects of the human being?
I think that biography helped us understand how humans have an impact on what happens in this world. These are ordinary people I write about: Jennifer Doudna, Steve Jobs, Ben Franklin, and yet, through their actions, they get to have an impact on the world. So I like telling the history of our time to the people who make it, because that can help inspire us to be more curious or to be more observant or to be more creative.
Some readers are afraid of scientific literature. This book actually reads like a novel to me, but what would you tell people that they can find, what would you tell the reader, the Spanish-speaking reader, that they can find in this book that will actually attract them and make them stay and read the whole book?
This is not a science book. This is a storytelling book. This is a detective story about a wonderful detective named Jennifer Doudna, and she decides to figure out the mysteries of life. And instead of making it like a science textbook, we go hand in hand with Jennifer Doudna as she makes these discoveries. And I try not to delve too deeply into the science because I want to make it an exciting and readable book. There's a joy in understanding how something works, especially when that something is ourselves.
And it's remarkable that she actually manages to be successful in spite of the fact that she lives in a world where discrimination against women is totally considered a normal part of life, even in the scientific world. Where does she get that strength that allows her to overcome misogyny and discrimination?
When she was a girl, a young girl in school, she read The Double Helix, the book about the structure of DNA that Jim Watson wrote. And she decided she wanted to become a scientist. But her high school guidance counselor told her, no, girls don't do science. Well, that just made her persist. And when she was a graduate student, most of the men were trying to decode DNA. But she knew that the key would be figuring out the structure of RNA. So she and a bunch of women started studying RNA. And I think it's because the women were collegial, but they were able to think different, that they're the ones who made the important discoveries.
And in fact, I find that in the book, at the same time, we find how some women researchers like Rosalind
Franklin,
Rosalind Franklin, I mean, she was actually put aside, and Watson and Crick actually took her information. Could you tell us something about that that episode that you actually recount in your book?
When Jennifer read The Double Helix by James Watson, she became fascinated with the character of Rosalind Franklin, who had done the images, sort of the X-ray photography that helped figure out the structure of DNA. And she doesn't get a lot of credit in the book. In fact, Dr. Watson treats her a bit dismissively, calls her Rosie. But it made Jennifer Doudna understand that women could become scientists. And it made me understand that sometimes women are written out of the history of science and technology. They don't get the credit that they're due. And so that's why it was wonderful to write this book about Jennifer Doudna.
Mr. Walter Isaacson, thank you very much for this conversation. I know we've had some technical problems. I think we've managed to solve them well. And I was fascinated by the book. Thank you for inviting us to read The Codebreaker.
Hey, those are really good questions. So thank you, and I hope it works out this show.
Thank you very much. Y a usted, amigo televidente, que hace posible este programa, se lo agradezco también. Esto es todo por hoy, pero no se le olvide. Nos vemos la próxima.